We welcome you all to this wonderful service of light and love the celebration of Christmas Eve, and the celebration, remembering that tomorrow our Savior will be born once again into our world. I have one announcement for us as we begin, and that is that those of you who have ordered poinsettias, you know who you are. We invite you to take them following the service, or to leave them and pick them up Sunday morning following that service. So I will leave that up to you. Also this year, because it's very hard, we tested it to blow out a candle with a mask on. So this year, for everyone's safety, we are going to use these, but we will still dim the lights, we will turn our candles on and have a moment with Silent Night, as is our tradition. We also have one other tradition, I guess, that we have started. We have a tradition in our church of passing the peace. Normally that means a handshake or a hug. Since COVID times, we have adapted and we do different things each week. I will spare you some of the goofy things I've made them do. I think the chicken dance might have been a favorite. But tonight I would like you to greet one another. And when we get to that, I invite you to put your hands together and say namaste, which is the God in me greets the God in you. The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pass the peace of Christ to one another.
Rejoice, people of God, the light has come into the world.
O God, now we light the candle of your nativity.
Thank you.
all through the season of Advent, as we prepared for Christmas, we have been exploring how we as a church can make more room in the inn, becoming more hospitable to the needs of our community. On this Christmas Eve, we declare that the inn is open for the business of compassion, and it's open with room enough for us all. The long-awaited Messiah has been born, and on him light shines. We have only to open the doors of our lives and to say, welcome. Our Advent journey has led us to this moment, when the light shining through the closed doors of life become an open door to new possibilities and new relationships. What a poignant moment for us this year, as the light, the hope, the peace, the joy, and the love multiplies from one illuminated heart to another.
Our scripture reading tonight comes from Isaiah chapter 9, verse 3 through 4, and then verse 6 through 7. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian, for a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon its shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onwards and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this.
Jesus foretold from Luke 1, 26 through 38. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel,
"How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called the Son of God. And now your relative, Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her.
I heard a shepherd boy crying on the way to Bethlehem.
Tonight, as we prepare to collect this evening's offering, we want to let you know that in light of all of the devastation in Kentucky, we are a part of and a contributor to Church World Service. And because of that existing organization, 100% of donations will go directly to help the people in Kentucky. So all of the offering tonight will be earmarked for that cause. Let us give freely in thanksgiving for the greatest gift we could ever receive, the gift of love that came down at Christmas in Jesus our Lord. Let us collect the evening offering.
Jesus, Luke chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn.
The shepherds and angels. In the region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and laying in a manger." And suddenly there was with an angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those who he favors."
I wonder as I wonder how Jesus the Savior did come for to die. Oh, When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told to them.
King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men came from the east to Jerusalem, asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet. And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who is to be shepherd my people, Israel."
Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time and where the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child. And when you have found him, bring me word so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there, ahead of them, went the star they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over a place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chests, they offered him the gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
A story once about a little 5-year-old boy named Johnny. He was in the kitchen one night with his mother as she made supper. And as her hands were messy from cooking, she asked little Johnny to go into the pantry and fetch a can of tomato soup for her. But he didn't want to go. So he refused, saying, "It's dark in there. I'm scared." But again, she asked, "Please go get me the soup." But he didn't want to go alone. Finally, she said, "It's okay, honey. You go and Jesus will be there with you." So Johnny walked slowly to the door and cracked it open and peeked inside, and it was dark, very dark. So he backed away and started to leave, but then he had an idea. He came back and he cracked the door open just a little and yelled, "Jesus, if you're in there, could you hand me a can of tomato soup?" Now, why was little Johnny afraid? Because it was dark in there. People have always been a little bit afraid of the dark. That's one of the reasons many of us have nightlights. If there's a strange noise in the night, I'd just as soon be able to see where it's coming from. I sure don't want to encounter things that go bump in the night without knowing what they are. The dark can be a scary place to be. The dark can hide scary things, and we don't want to be alone. The dark can rob us of our courage, of our hope, of our faith. And what all of us have discovered is that at times this world can be a dark place. That's why when God created the world, one of the first things God said was, "Let there be light." And that's why God created the sun and the moon and the stars, to give light to the dark places. And that's why when God saw darkness continuing in our lives, God decided to send his son Jesus. He sent Jesus into the world to be the light that shines in darkness. Jesus came so that we would never have to be afraid in the dark alone again. But now our job as people of faith is to let our lights shine. And I'm sure when I say that, it's hard for many of you not to think of the song, "This Little Light of Mine," because we're all taught from a young age that we need to let our light shine and not hide it under a bushel. But let's think about that for a moment. If I were to take a lit candle and place it under a basket, what would happen? It would shine through. Even under the basket, we would be able to see glimmers of that light. But if I were to place a basket tightly over the top of a candle, with an actual flame, and I'm not going to do that here. But what would happen? One of two things. Eventually, either that candle would go out or the basket would catch on fire. So what are we to learn from that this night? We are here together right now, gathered in a lowly manger, listening to the feet shuffling of the donkey, the cud chewing of the cows, yet our eyes remain transfixed on the beautiful baby lying in a manger, the one around whom a glow seems to hover and a hush seems to fall. Mary and Joseph have done their parts to bring Jesus into the world, and as we once again approach the humble birthplace of our Savior, what is asked of us? Perhaps all of a sudden it's clear to us that the light of Christ cannot be hidden, and it is our job to find ways to step out of the way of the light so that God can shine brightly and God's radiance will not be hindered in any way. How do we do that? First, I'd like us to think about a time when you were in a dimly lit place and you were trying to read something, and the only light was behind you. You squinted, maybe you put your glasses on, but still you struggled to see because you were standing in the way of the only light. You were blocking the light so all you could see was shadow. So what did you do? I bet you shifted to the side so the light could better shine on what needed to be illuminated. We are still people who walk in a land of darkness. So it is just as important for us today to find a way to keep even the dimmest burning candle lit, to find ways to move ourselves out of the way of the light so that the light will shine more brightly and so that we will not cast shadows on anyone around us. So on this holy of nights, this holiest one, as we see in a moment the candles lit all around us, as we see the Christmas lights shine on houses on our way home, and perhaps as we see a star lit on the top of our very own Christmas tree, let us give thanks for the light that has once again come into our world, and let us leave renewed with a sense of purpose, inspired with a desire to share Christ's light with others, and filled to glowing with the presence of God. For it is when God's love shines brightly through our lives that we cannot help but radiate the love of God to one another. And just like that little baby many, many years ago, we can become a light of hope to all around us. For Jesus came into this world to bring a great light, a light of hope and love to all who walk in darkness. With Jesus' help, it is now our turn. Go and be the light of love. Amen. And Merry Christmas.
Oh,
This is the moment we've been waiting for. This is the moment we missed so much last year. Yes, we found ways to pass the light from one to another across the distance, knowing that nothing could extinguish the light of God in this world, knowing that Christ was with us and always will be. But oh, how good it is to be those of us gathered here in this holy house together, those of us still gathered at home joining us. And for those who are watching online, we feel you and we know you are there. And we're so glad you can join us in this moment with a candle lit at your own holy home. The Spirit makes it possible for us to be connected, as we found out last year. We invite you, as become our COVID tradition, to hum Silent Night along with the quartet. And I invite you, as they begin, to turn on your light, to let your light shine and to raise it in the darkness, reminded of the steadfastness of its message and the light that still shines. Open wide their doors and let Christ enter again. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.